So good evening, everyone. I'm very pleased to be here. I'm very pleased to see this community coming together. Now, I will start with some lead-in, which is a question for all of you. I don't know whether you saw this before, but there are two pills here. One of them is blue, one of them is red. I apologize to those who are colorblind. And I will ask you to raise your hand if you prefer to take the blue pill, which means that you can actually walk out and keep your own understanding and notions about quantum computing to yourself. We have here also the red pill, which means that you will hear some unsettling truth, hopefully truth, about quantum computing, and you will have to live with that for the rest of your life. So who is taking the blue pill? Okay, we have here a few hands. I'm surprised. Great. And who is staying with us until the bitter end to hear? Okay, and we always have quantum state people in superposition. That's okay. We love you all. So the purpose of this panel is to foster an honest, transparent, and responsible discussion in about the prospect of quantum computing. I'm very pleased here to have a few brilliant panelists. We couldn't be more fortunate than having them. And I will introduce them by one. So the first one is Marco Cirquengo, a senior quantum algorithm scientist from Phasecraft. We have here Dee Fang, assistant professor at the mathematics department in Duke, and also at the Duke Quantum Center. And we have Alex Dalzell, a research scientist at AWS Center for Quantum Computing. So as you all know, there's a lot of public attention giving these days to quantum computing. I guess part of it is the reason we are all here. Now, it has been captivating our imagination in many ways. We hear about exciting advancements. But also, there are some here and there pompous declarations upon the impact and or forthcoming impact of quantum computing and quantum technologies more generally. For those of you who are aware, Scott Aronson released a nice blog with the title, I will try to make it work. Oh, maybe I should have. Hope and Hype in Quantum Computing. And there's also a very nice cartoon that we saw earlier in Bert's slide called The Talk. I warmly recommend to look into that. Now, it does highlight some of the conceptions and misconceptions associated with quantum computing in particular. Now, as with every other research topic, we do hear about many successes. We often less hear about the failures and about the dead ends. And what we wanted to do here is not only to hear about them. I don't want you to all be depressed, but we would like to spare you a lot of wasted effort and hear about the potential dead ends early on so we can focus on, hopefully, the open roads ahead. Now, De Vincenzo provided desiderata for quantum hardware to be viable many years ago. And one of the first questions that I would like to ask the panel here is, what would be the desiderata for quantum computing algorithms? So what are the requirements that we would like to put forward for this for such computable or computational model? And I would like to hear, maybe I will start we would like to constrain the discussion to fundamental characteristics and potentially limitations of this computational model as opposed to technological or technical challenges. So we will not talk about error correction and noise and things that we believe can be resolved by a lot of engineering effort, but we actually would like to hear more about some fundamental limitations and maybe characteristics of this this computational model. I can start maybe with an open question, right? So what are the inherent limitations of quantum computing that you believe can prevent it from becoming mainstream technology? And if any of you would like to step forward, please go ahead. Or otherwise, I can provide you some titles and then we can do it that way.
I think I will first talk about a little bit of my definition or some of us definition of exponential quantum speedup. We have heard about a lot of discussions about exponential quantum speedup and so on and so forth, the hope and so on for today. But I believe if we actually want to make that claim, as has many of the speakers mentioned, it's actually very difficult to actually truly make that claim, is that if you want to make that claim, you should at least satisfy the following criteria, which are basically, as mathematicians, then they are mathematical theorem we need to prove. First of all, you have very well-defined computational problems. First of all, you want to prove it's quantumly easy, which means that you have a quantum algorithm, which is what you constructed, or maybe someone else has constructed, and you want to prove as a theorem, saying that, okay, under these conditions, it has a polylog dependence as the complexity, as the cost. And at the same time, one have to, in order to say there is an exponential speedup, one have to prove as a theorem saying that it's classically hard. Then what are the criteria should we look for this classical hardness? What are the acceptable theorem to do that? I think there are two different criteria. One would be if this is a very well-studied computation problem, such as integer factoring, which has been studied by so many people for different fields, decades and decades. So we generically would believe the best known algorithm that exists today, including all of the classical algorithm, including, you know, probably algorithm as well as deterministic algorithm. You cannot just compare with one single algorithm or a category of algorithm. You have to compare with all of the algorithm, and then you show that, you know, the classical complexity is say exponential of that order, exponential of polylog. And then this is okay, as I said, if only the task has been studied already by many, many people in different fields, and people is okay with saying that, okay, the best case scenario is actually, you know, the actual algorithm is what is omitted. This alternative criteria, which many of the speakers have already mentioned, is that another way that you actually want to justify, what if I just created a computational problem myself, there hasn't been studied, you know, for many people for many years, then at least you should show that your computational problem under the same, you know, conditions where you actually have an efficient quantum algorithm, that this problem is BQP hard, which means that, you know, under reasonable complexity conjecture, such as BQP does not equal to BPP, however that means, it just means that whether a algorithm, classical algorithm exists or not, under reasonable complexity conjecture, you do not expect that they will have, you know, polynomial, polylog cost as a result. So I feel like if any of us actually are getting excited about various different questions, which is fantastic, I would just like to suggest be a little bit mindful when we try to make any of these sort of claims, exponential speedup, we have to, you know, as mathematicians, I guess a good rule of thumb is to say that we cannot claim anything until we prove it, right? So unless we prove these two criteria, at least as a theorems, we cannot, I mean, claim there is an exponential speedup.
That's okay. Thank you, Dee. Okay. So, anyone else wants to comment on that, or so we, in really in few words, Dee was referring to probability of quantum algorithms and contrasting them with the best classical algorithms that we know of. I can throw out a few other topics unless you would like to jump with others. Please, yeah.
So, just to comment on the title of the panel discussion, Hope and Hype. So let me take a step back and say that, the issue of hype in quantum computing, as in many other areas today, is unfortunate. It's not a problem only of quantum computing, it's a problem of media broadly. So I don't see that as a specific problem of the scientific field of quantum computing. But it is especially unfortunate in some sense because quantum computing doesn't need any hype because it's an absolutely fascinating field that has made enormous progress experimentally and theoretically over the last decade. And it's very exciting, and the hype only kind of works against it. Perhaps to second what Fang just said, It is quite remarkable that there exist quantum algorithms, at least on paper, that can give exponential speedups over classical algorithms. This is a quite a non-trivial thing. And it's difficult to overhype it, in fact, because it's a really remarkable discovery. So this, as you all know, started in, with the original insights of Richard Feynman and others that realized that nature provides us with this computational resource that when you plug it in into your quantum algorithms, it seems to give you an exponential quantum advantage. And in fact, one can prove this provided some complexity theoretic assumptions. And this is a remarkable fact about the world, about the physical world, that quantum entanglement and interference is a resource that we can tap into, and it gives us additional computational powers. But even though this resource exists, at the beginning there was some skepticism by prominent figures in the field that this could ever be used in a practical manner. But then a second remarkable discovery was made, namely the threshold theorem, that shows that if you're able to control your qubits with a certain level of precision below a certain threshold, then from that moment on, you can perform arbitrarily long quantum computations, which is not obvious that it should be the case. So these two remarkable facts shouldn't be ignored. And the question on whether how you can have certainty on whether these ideas and these resources actually give you quantum speedups in practical problems is something which is very difficult to prove. And one can prove them, in very specific situations. But this is not something which is only about quantum computing, it's also true about classical computing, and complexity theory has its limitations. In fact, by the predictions of many theorists, machine learning, classical machine learning, should not exist, it should not work, and that's what many people believed. And then it's only when people just got them running, finally, with GPUs and so on, that now theorists are scratching their heads, trying to figure out why it works. So quantum computing could be in a similar situation, and I would say as a rule of thumb, and I'll pass it over to my other panelists now, as a rule of thumb, I would say that it is because quantum algorithms are based on quantum mechanics, the closer the application is to quantum mechanics, the less hurdles the quantum algorithm will have to hop over in order to give you an exponential advantage that we know is there at a fundamental level. So if you're trying to decide in the absence of formal proofs what is a better direction to go into, it is a good rule of thumb, in my opinion, to focus on problems which are the closer to quantum mechanics, the better. As you move away from that, it becomes more challenging. Okay.
Thank you, Marcos. Yeah, Alex, please.
Yeah, I guess I definitely feel very similarly to them, and I think it kind of reflects the feeling of people who are clear-eyed about this whole project of quantum computing. Maybe one thing I would say is, I guess, especially in response to this last comment about working on problems that are closer to quantum mechanics, I agree with this. I guess the one major exception to this is Shor's algorithm, which is really, I think it's sort of hard to overstate the how important Shor's algorithm has been to quantum computing, right? It's 30 years this year since it was discovered, and quantum computing sort of didn't exist. I mean, some people had worked on very basic versions of quantum computing before then, but that really changed everything. And I mean, it's so weird that there's a speed up in Shor's algorithm in some sense. It's this weird number theoretic fact, and there had to be this very specific quantum algorithm for it. And I think maybe people after that thought that there might be tons and tons of other random problems that have nothing to do with quantum mechanics that we could find quantum algorithms for with exponential speedups. And I don't think that has been the case. I think that there have been smaller speedups for some other problems that are not related to quantum mechanics, and maybe one day those will be useful. But those are generally not large enough to be at the point where we would expect them to actually come to fruition in the near intermediate term. So, I don't know. It's just interesting to reflect on that. Because I might also say that Shor's algorithm, if we're talking about the desiderata of quantum computing, quantum algorithms. Like, Shor's algorithm kind of satisfies all of them except maybe one, which is that it's not really that useful for, actual industrial applications besides breaking, breaking codes, which is maybe not necessarily the best application that we'd like to have much more interesting applications, I think.
Okay, thank you, Alex. And by the way, maybe just to connect what both of you said, for those of you who are familiar with Shor algorithm, at some level, if you would like to think about it as an algorithm that has a physical realization, it is nothing but an interferometer that you shine multiple wavelengths, and the moment they conclude a complete integer number of repetition, you have interference, and that is really a factor, right? So it has actually a very nice physical realization if you think about it. Now, just to ponder a little bit more on that, because I do know that many of us have a little bit more of a novice background in quantum computing, and I would like you to be aware of some of the shortcuts that can be taken when you read about the new exciting articles, and you need to have a little bit of a critical eye. So I would like to highlight the topic and tell me whether one of you can provide more insight. One important element when we design algorithms in quantum is whether those algorithms can be end-to-end algorithms, meaning we start in the classical world, we compute something in the classical computer, and then the result is received in the classical world. And many algorithms, I would say, assume somehow that the data mysteriously got into the quantum computer without being ported inside. I would like to hear maybe from the panelists a little bit about that aspect and whether there are some suggestions for the classes of problems to be focused upon or what questions we should ask ourselves when we look into some new algorithms out there. Any volunteers? Alex, you wrote a 300 plus pages about end-to-end algorithms. You're probably the most qualified person here.
The algorithms group at AWS, we like to think about this end-to-end idea where, to kind of maybe force ourselves to be more systematic about how we evaluate a quantum algorithm and make sure we aren't overselling something or brushing something under the rug. You really need to make sure that the every step of the algorithm is accounted for. And it can be easy to not do that because a lot of the very great work that's been done on quantum algorithms has focused on like parts of the quantum algorithm and really optimized that. And this has been really crucial for the development of quantum algorithms because we really have needed to focus on what is it about quantum mechanics that allows a quantum algorithm to be to potentially provide a speed up and really focus down on that one fundamental component. And so we've found like query separation. So you might have some black box problem and you can prove very rigorously that your quantum algorithm only requires a certain number of queries to this black box, but the classical algorithm requires far more queries. But if you're at a company and you want to eventually solve a real problem for a real user, a black box example is not really going to be useful. You have to use that black box algorithm together with a real instantiation of the black box. You have to connect it to an actual problem that someone is actually trying to solve that they can't solve some other way. You have to make sure we don't have these computers yet, so we can't kind of try it out and show that, oh, we did it with only a certain amount of time. Like, so we have to estimate how much time it will take given certain assumptions, and so it's very easy to forget something or to just for simplicity assume that a certain step takes certain amount of effort, but like when you actually inspect that assumption, it becomes seeming less realistic. So yeah, I don't know. I guess this is the whole philosophy, and I think it is possible to have some optimism about quantum computing when you think through it this way, but it really forces you to set aside many of the things that some people in some places have said, oh, there's going to be this huge advantage in this area. And So on the flip side, you can become more confident in the things that do kind of pass all these tests because they've passed all these tests, which is nice.
Maybe I would like to just comment a little bit about the input, the so-called input and output issue. If you have heard of it, great. Otherwise, I will explain a little bit. So, it's very attempting, as someone who are working on, as myself, who works on classical algorithms, and we work into the field of quantum computing, we have amazing, challenging problems, nonlinear differential equations and machine learning tasks and so on and so forth. We hope that quantum can give us the universal solution, in a sense, give us, as long as I run my classical algorithm on a quantum computer, I hope, magic comes up and I have exponential speed up, which we already know that is merely not the case. For example, there are various different levels of output problems. I will just address a little bit of some examples of what kind of output problem you may have. So first of all, imagine you have a classical problem, can be classical machine learning, can be your Fourier differential equation that you want to simulate, or can be a numerical linear algebra problem that you want to simulate. So what quantum computer get you at the end, as Alex was saying, is that it have a quantum state that is encoding the information. And quantum states are L2 normalized, which means that you lose the amplitude information. So still for these problems, for example, if you look at quantum linear system problem, or the algorithm, the first algorithm to solve that is HHL, the output is indeed a quantum state. You can still prove it's BQP hard, which means that even for the simplified problems, you do not expect generically, polylog algorithm classically. But nevertheless, you should be mindful, the end product of these algorithms are actually a quantum state. And then what do you do with a quantum state? Okay, you get this quantum state using polylog calculations, but what do you do with it? You want to read out the information, which typically involves some tomography, and very likely, depending on what kind of information you need, if you just, you need a constant number of observables, perhaps you are okay. However, if you want to read out the whole information of the quantum state, then you can imagine this exponential speedup is coming back, because that's the size of the quantum state that you're looking at is polynomial in versus, So this is one output issue. What you do with the quantum state? This is one output issue that are typically hindering people from claiming exponential speedup. Now, if we take a step back, if we're saying, okay, I'm okay with outputting a quantum state that is proportional to the actual classical C vector that I want to simulate, then the question is, there will still be a probability issue. This will then date it back to, Burst talk and as well as Jeff's talk today, is that even if you are okay, say, for a quantum linear system solver, you are okay, finally the output is just a quantum state. Still, there are various different things you need to check. It's because be mindful that quantum computing are operating things on unit trees, and then you make some measurements. So either there are, measurements are pretty much projections. If you can break down this whole thing as unitary measurement in the end, then you can efficiently simulate them. However, all of these, numerical linear algebra and so on and so forth, these operations are not unitary. So you do not expect them to immediately implement on a quantum computer. That is what Bert mentioned in his talk, is that how do you actually implement it as a quantum gate, so on, is what you do is so-called block encoding. You want to sort of dilate your matrix, which is non-unitary, and input it inside of a matrix. Then you immediately realize some issue is going on. It's because operator norm of a matrix can be arbitrary large. However, the operator norm of the unitary is just one. So you cannot just arbitrarily put a matrix there. You need to divide it by, for example, the size of the matrix or the operator norm of the matrix. In doing so, you are enlarging your original problem space by a little bit, which is typically not significant. But be mindful, only this part of information is the actual information you needed, which is the non-unitary things. So you apply it to a quantum state. You get a quantum state. However, there's only one piece of information you need, so you need to sort of post-select. This comes with a success probability. Now it goes back to what Jeff mentioned about quantum linear system solver. So for different applications, the success probability will be associated with different parameters. For quantum linear system solver, it's associated with condition number, and for different problem, it's associated with various different things. So just want to say that for the output issue, even for that, one needs to be very careful to analyze, what's the success probability? Can my algorithm actually be meaningful? That's already a very important thing to look at. I can say more about input problem, but I guess I will not hijack the conversation.
Okay, then thank you, Dee. Maybe since we have a bit more than 10 minutes and we would like to touch on a few other topics, let me ask you the implications of some of those characteristics of the computational model of quantum computers, right? So I will summarize them as we have a very interesting interface of input-output, right? We need to have a small input, big compute, small dimensional output. We may prefer to restrict ourselves potentially to problems that are more linear in their nature, because the nature of what quantum computing can do is linear operation in a very fast manner. You mentioned provability, right? We would like to ensure that algorithms that we craft have, if it is possible, to find such bounds or provable bounds so that we are not deceiving ourselves to believe that we have managed to do something beyond what we can do. And I guess I think Alex mentioned usefulness at some aspect. So we would like to have useful algorithms. I would like to ask, what are the implications of some of those characteristics upon few application areas? So I can throw some of them, and you can jump with those that you may prefer to tackle. I have recombinatorial optimization, homology, quantum chemistry, quantum machine learning, nonlinear differential equations. So if any of you would like to take one of them, we can do that.
Okay, maybe I can comment.
Please.
So you mentioned just now some challenges for quantum algorithms, one of them being the input-output problem that was just alluded to. And you also mentioned non-linearity, which is something which is very important in machine learning applications, and that's what gives, you know, the power to machine learning algorithms. I would say, just to frame things maybe a little bit differently, this is kind of one aspect of why quantum algorithms and machine learning algorithms are fundamentally very different. And machine learning algorithms are useful for solving problems which don't have a lot of structure. So if you want to, you know, do image recognition, for example, it's hard to codify exactly what a cat or a dog is. But you can easily teach a neural network to learn that. Quantum algorithms are really kind of on the opposite set end of that. They are expected by design and from the fundamentals of the theory to solve problems that have a very specific kind of structure, namely a quantum mechanical structure. So, in my view, forcing quantum mechanics to solve machine learning problems is a little ill-posed from the beginning. And you should not expect that you find obstacles when you try to do that. That's one comment.
Yeah,
and the other comment, I would also comment on the challenge of solving problems which are not related to machine learning, classical machine learning, but to optimization, cryptography, and so on. I would really encourage and advertise the wonderful review by Alex and collaborators. It's called Quantum Algorithms and an Analysis of End-to-End Applications and Their Resources. Quantum Algorithms End-to-End, you'll find on Google. It will give you a little bit of a feeling of kind of the challenge in front of us to really implement algorithms which are of eventual practical and industrial application. You will see, for example, I learned from there that if you want to do cryptography, if you want to break RSA, you would need something like 14,000 logical qubits, whereas at the moment we have maybe one logical qubit, and the order of billions of gates, whereas now we have the order of thousands of gates. So this is a really, really long road ahead of us. And it's not clear, but you can also see from the review, where is it that optimization and other problems of that sort fall in this trajectory. And we're very, very really at the initial stages. And I believe you would also see that in many of the problems reviewed there, the problems which are, again, more closely related to quantum mechanics require less resources. And that's because the quantum algorithm has to, you know, go over less hoops in order to give some advantage.
I guess I should say like the way that you like to think about the different applications. It's important to start with kind of understanding its asymptotic speed up, like its best potential, right? Like in optimization, the kind of starting point is this quadratic speed up from Grover's algorithm, which is really flexible. It applies in many situations, but it's also very hard to surpass the quadratic speed up. And maybe it's important to communicate to people entering the field that there's kind of an understanding among people who work on resource estimation for like kind of intermediate term, like, you know, imagine that we just scale up what we have, we follow the path we're going, there's no huge change to where we're going, like where will that take us? There's kind of an understanding that a quadratic speedup won't be enough to actually surpass classical computing. And that comes from a kind of practical analysis of the actual devices we expect to have. So the fact that the fastest hardware that we can imagine having, you know, the quantum error correction cycle time is one megahertz. So you have like 1 microsecond for every cycle, and it's going to take several cycles to perform one step of your quantum algorithm. And you're starting at a much slower clock speed than you would start classically, because classical computers are super duper fast, right? More like a gigahertz clock speed. And so you start way behind, and you need to make up all that ground with an asymptotic speed up. And when you run the numbers, the quadratic speed up is usually not really enough to make up that ground. You could take the problem size large enough so that you would cross over. That's what it means for there to be an asymptotic speed up. But the size at which you would see this crossover is just too large to be practically useful. That doesn't mean that like we won't have some revolution that reduces the clock speeds of quantum computers increases them to the, you know, much closer to what classical computers have. But that's kind of currently how people think about it. So that would cover optimization. A lot of machine learning algorithms were once thought to potentially have exponential speedups, but we now understand that many of them have at best polynomial speedups. Polynomial meaning quadratic or potentially cubic or quartic, like something higher than quadratic but not exponential. A lot of chemistry algorithms, chemistry is closer to quantum mechanics, so we hope to have exponential speedups because of the fact that we can digitally represent our molecule natively on a quantum computer with all of its entanglement and everything in a very native way. But the problem there is a different one, and it's that the classical chemists are too good at their job. They have, for decades, developed these amazing classical methods that use all of their chemical intuition to make approximations of these molecules and get out very useful answers in polynomial time. And so, you know, what the quantum computer can provide there is more accuracy, potentially, in some examples. And then there's a lot of work to kind of find an end-to-end example of a problem where such accuracy is needed, where you would actually be able to provide some value to someone by solving this problem to very low accuracy that you couldn't solve otherwise. I think drug discovery is a great example because it turns out that a lot of the computational problems within the drug discovery pipeline don't really need to be done to that high of accuracy, at least in the current way the pipeline is set up. And so people will say, oh, quantum computing will help drug discovery. And the reason is that, molecules are quantum. I wouldn't say like never, there would never be any improvement for drug discovery, but we have to be more creative about how the quantum computer will help there, because I don't think that we can't just insert it and hope that it will just magically make everything better.
Maybe I just have a quick comment or like a clarification. When we say quantum chemistry problem, quantum chemical problem already, it's a problem, maybe problematic, may not be a sort for exponential speedup, people might be very worried. But just to say, if you are working on quantum dynamics, if you are working on dynamics, then there's no issue at all. Like, there's everything that we just talk about, input issue, output issue, you know, successful, no issue at all. You know, quantum dynamics, definitely. But ground state, maybe or maybe not, depending on, you know, how you compare with classical.
Yeah, that's a
different regime. Yeah,
I agree with that.
Okay, so we are actually at almost at time, or actually at time. So I would like to ask each of you to provide a very short takeaway message to this audience as for your recommendation, as for maybe the topics that they should focus on or conduct that they may better focus on in their quest or journey into the quantum computing world.
But I do not have a short answer. So I guess I will just say a little bit about, because I am a mathematician, I'm not trained traditionally in quantum chemistry and so on and so forth, or quantum physics. And I changed my path into quantum computing. So I do feel like, although we're talking about many sort of, you know, hype message, but there's a lot of opportunities indeed for mathematicians to get into this field. Specifically, I feel like there are four different levels of theoretical problems where mathematicians, we do not work on experiments. So theoretical levels. So first is that define your computational problems. Can you justify there is an exponential separation from classical quantum? Or is there any, you know, polynomial separation, any sort of separation? This is like a great problem to work on. Then the second layer would be, given these problems where you already have, you know, separations quantumly and classically, what is, you know, quantumly the lower bounds for this algorithm? What is the best quantum algorithm as an upper bound? And you can match all of the parameters, at least asymptotically. You can claim that asymptotically this is optimal algorithm. No one can improve upon, you know, the asymptotic behavior. And after that, we have various different applications. For different applications, as Alex has mentioned, the practical, you know, the practical number of resources may not be the be actually the most, you know, asymptotically optimal one give you the better performance, because, you know, n to the n squared, depending on the constant, may be significantly larger than n to the 1,000. Then for various different applications that we do care about, then the next question would be compare all of the existing algorithm and cast out the resource estimation of the quantum resource and get a concrete number to compare all different algorithms. This will be very much like simulation based, and I guess many of us can contribute. And then the last level would be, you know, talk to the experimentalists, work with the hardware, and try to model the noise and try to do something with the noise in a non-trivial way. These are, I think, four different things that are all where mathematicians can come in. It's just...
Thank you, Dee. Marcus or Alex?
Sure, I guess, I don't know, sorry, the best takeaway message, but I guess I often think about what the analogy is for quantum computing in terms of like the timeline of classical computing. Like, where are we? Are we in the 1940s? Are we in the 1980s? You know, what is, and I think we really are very early on, you know, like in the 1940s, 1950s, like they hadn't discovered the transistor, they hadn't discovered the integrated circuit, and they would never have believed that there were such great computers that we have today. And I think, how did they get there? Like, there was like a lot of very, you know, small, like, you know, thousands and thousands of very small contributions from a lot of people to solve a lot of problems. And I think it's similar for us. I think that's the optimistic case for quantum computing. And I think, yeah, I think there's a lot of problems to be solved and a lot of places to contribute. And I think applied mathematicians definitely, I mean, I think, yeah, almost everywhere in those problems would be able to contribute. It's easy to get pessimistic because you can see all of these problems you need to solve in front of you, but I think you can also be optimistic.
Thank you, Alex. Marcus?
Yeah, I would say that it's a wonderful field with many opportunities for major discoveries. I also feel like we're in the very early beginnings of the field, and there are many opportunities for mathematicians, of course, to help improve the algorithms that exist and prove, you know, theorems about complexity separations and so on, but also perhaps most importantly of all, to help the community find new targets for quantum computers. We have very limited ideas. There are maybe two or three broad categories, and I think we probably need, I think Scott Aronson has put it this way, we need more targets for quantum computers. So help us.
Thank you very much. So that concludes this session. You're welcome to reach out to the panelists after the session and bug them with questions. Thank you very much for listening, and again, thank you very much to the panelists.